This is the beginning of an end. Since the outbreak of the coronavirus, developed into a worldwide pandemic, as declared by the World Health Organization on the 12th of March, this has become unavoidably clear. Yet, stranded in our isolations, it is easy to miss the real meaning of this fact. To see through the cages of fear erected about us is difficult and dangerous. There are some perspectives which allow no such confusion. And so we speak first of the elderly abandoned in care homes, the disabled and autistic people deemed unworthy of saving, and the prisoners chained together by iron and disease. The British care sector provides a clear example. By providing all medical activity with legal indemnity, releasing health guidelines which suggest that requiring assistance managing finances may make one ineligible for critical care, and even directly funneling the virus into care homes, the Johnson government has nudged deep structural contradictions and brought about the complete collapse of the care sector. Eugenics by bureaucracy. The victims are vast in number. Just care homes, 0.62% of Britain's population, accounting for at least a quarter of the nation's COVID-19 deaths by the 12th of May. In this cull, we can see the essential form of what is today being born. Capitalism is formed into an extinction cult. It offers only a politics of annihilation.
We are still faced with extraordinary uncertainty about the depth and duration of this crisis. It is already clear, however, that global growth will turn sharply negative in 2020, as you will see in our World Economic Outlook next week. In fact, we anticipate the worst economic fallout since the Great Depression.
Capitalism has had the fatal heart attack. This is a coma. One can see this plainly in the scale of the economic crash before us, which the IMF project will bring global growth to -3% in 2020. By contrast, the 2008 crash led to a fall in global growth of -0.1%. Whilst it is broadly acknowledged that this amounts to the worst crash since the Great Depression, this is still putting it mildly. Commodity prices are a clear example. The fallout from the 2008 crash, bringing the annual return on commodities to negative rates comparable only with those seen in the 30s, by as early as 2015, and keeping them there. A projection that we will see global commodity prices and trade collapse, unlike anything we've seen since the 1930s, from the former chief economist of the IMF, Ken Rogoff, in early April, thus suggests a collapse of commodity prices on at least the same scale as the Great Depression, but begins at a low point comparable only to those seen well into the Great Depression. Already, this is creating an avalanche of government debt crises in particularly the oppressed world. Over 90 countries, around half of the world's nations, inquiring about IMF loans, and 60 looking to gain access to a World Bank program by just early April. The combined resources of the IMF and the World Bank for this crisis is a paltry $1.2 trillion. Not enough to even dent this gathering demand. Should the US Federal Reserve attempt to intervene, the money printing that this would require would likely send the dollar into hyperinflation due to the sheer scale of the hard currency required. Should governments default on their debt instead, hyperdeflation will precede this hyperinflation. Oil, now victim to a price war, has broken. US crude crashing from $18 a barrel to a world historic minus $38 in a matter of hours on the 20th of April. Whilst the dust may settle for the occasional rally, these are early days and the damage is exponential. The bottom has fallen out of everything.
You know the price of oil right now, don't you?
I do. Do you know the price of oil?
I actually do.
It's negative $37.
Of course, yeah. Nobody's ever heard of negative oil before, but it's for a short term. If we could buy it for nothing, we're going to take everything we can get. The only thing I like better than that is where they pay you to take the oil. But that's a short-term squeeze. You understand that. So it's I don't think you're going to see that. But no, we'd like to have Congress. This is a great time to buy oil.
Let's talk now about another potential effect of this worldwide pandemic. It is a healthcare crisis, to be sure, but it is also one that could hit people in their very survival, their ability to survive in the food supply. Multiple famines of biblical proportions, that is a bleak warning that is coming from the director of the World Food Program.
The Labor Department says another 3.8 million people filed for unemployment benefits last week, bringing the total over the last 6 weeks to more than 30 million.
Really, those numbers are just absolutely brutal.
The totalizing nature of this collapse and the frenetic pace at which it is unfolding are the result of what may roughly be considered as two factors. The first, that is the virus, is easily seen, but less commonly understood. Simply put, COVID-19 has brought about a collapse of the spatial requirements of capitalist production and exchange, necessarily socialized processes in compact physical areas. Save for those industries deemed essential, or where capital is concentrated by new forms of online distribution monopoly, particularly Amazon. This shock, which would strike at the foundation of any society, has stirred deep contradictions within imperialist capitalism, which represent the second factor determining our present trajectory. As Karl Marx foresaw, capitalism has experienced a continued decline in the ratio of return to investment, the rate of profit, with an acceleration of this decline following the advent of neoliberalism in the 1970s and 80s, and the rapid redivision of the world between imperialist power blocks following the collapse of the Soviet Union. By 2016, these contradictions within the constitution of capitalist production reached a world-historic culmination and began to produce deadly antagonisms between increasingly nationalistic factions of the capitalist class. This process put capitalism on an incredibly brittle and uneven terrain, its institutions hollowed out by a ravenous hunt for profit, war upon the horizon, and the looming spectre of the environmental crisis, promising some form of collapse. The pandemic has brought these contradictions to the fore globally, and brought about an irreparable structural collapse without precedent. Rome would blush.
As Mika said, that number now over just the last 6 weeks is more than 30 million people. There are 328 million people in this country, so you can do the math on that. You're pushing 10% of Americans in the last 6 weeks who've lost their jobs.
Floor to ceiling, box after box. This vast warehouse in Merseyside is full of personal protection equipment for medical use. It's hard to believe such quantities exist in the UK, but the question is not how much there is, but why on earth is it still in here?
I'm here today for all the doctors, nurses and healthcare workers who lost their lives tragically and senselessly to COVID. And despite being told we have enough protection, lives are still being lost. Vulnerable members of staff are losing their lives and they're not being taken care of. And we know that because they're dying.
Both the hollowing out of institutions in the West and the impact of the virus upon these decayed husks is quite immediately evident with regard to healthcare. Britain identified a pandemic of a novel influenza as the most severe and likely threat to its integrity in the early 2000s and initially made preparations, as evidenced by the increase in the NHS's emergency stockpile funding between 2008 and 2011. The austerity policies necessitated by the 2008 financial crash not only brought this process to a stall, but reversed it. Between 2013 and 2018, 40% of this budget was eliminated. Not only this, but the NHS's broader capacity was decimated, with around 18% of hospital beds eliminated and budget growth falling to less than a half of its average in the decade following 2010. This looting has drastically deepened the impact of the virus. In the US, a similar process is in motion. The outsourcing of much medical production has left the US healthcare industry bereft of supply, with costs increasing enormously. Due to the structure of this industry, which sees frontline or in-home services receive the smallest budgets, those who most need equipment are most often those without it. The response to this crisis borders on farce. The Trump administration cutting the US's pandemic early warning program in September 2019, a mere 3 months before COVID-19 was detected in Wuhan. Whilst the decay seen in these instances is certainly the most profound, what is being unveiled in the particulars of Europe's hollowing is demonstrative of the power relations at play on the continent. That those nations most impacted by the virus within the European Union, that is, Italy and Spain, were brutally robbed by a decade of imposed austerity is no accident of misfortune. Across the West, capitalism's insatiable hunt for profit has carved out and liquidated the assets required to fight the virus, deeply prolonging its collapse of the spatial requirements of capitalist production. The example of healthcare provides illustration of a way in which the virus and the structural contradictions of capitalist society are interacting, one feeding the other. And a small view into the process of collapse, today driving capitalism's historical development. However, to begin to appreciate the scale and volatility of this process, it is necessary to grasp a particular element of the global context it is occurring within. Simply put, the collapse of capitalism today also represents the collapse of US imperialism's dominance.
And we're not happy about it, and we are by far the largest contributor to WHO, World Health, and they misled us. I don't know. They must have known more than they knew, because they came after what other people knew that weren't even involved. We knew things that they didn't know, and either they didn't know or they didn't tell us, or, right now they're They're literally a pipe organ for China. That's the way I view it. So we're seeing and we're looking and we're watching. And
a person at the White House used the term kung flu. Yeah. My question is, do you think that's wrong, kung flu? And do you think using the term Chinese virus, that puts Asian Americans at risk, that people might target them?
No. I think they probably would agree with it 100%. It comes from China. There's nothing not to agree. Okay, how about last question? Please go ahead.
Prior to the pandemic, U.S. imperialism was slowly fighting and losing a contest of so-called great power competition against China, Russia, and the European Union in a desperate bid to maintain its dominance. Since the virus hit, this dominance has all but evaporated. Nowhere is this clearer than in the instance of the dollar, the world's currency anchor and the US's biggest tactical asset, which has seen the anchors of its power untethered in but weeks. The specific relation by which the status of the dollar is assured in an economic sense, it being the only currency which may be used to purchase oil due to a political agreement with the OPEC oil cartel, has been used to dig its grave. With Russia and Saudi Arabia beginning a price war in mid-March, the oil industry has been forced into collapse and a fatal trap sprung. The motivation for this has come from particular contradictions internal to the historical nature of US imperialism's waning power. Namely, that the prices imposed upon OPEC by the US have amounted to a demand to subsidize US shale gas since the nation became the world's largest exporter. The virus has provided a tactical window in which Russia and Saudi Arabia's actions may prove fatal for the US. The decline in demand brought by worldwide COVID-19 lockdowns, dramatically exacerbating the price decline brought by price cuts and increasing supply. Should the US wish to stabilize the price of oil, upon which a great deal of its power rests, there are but two methods: either hyperinflation from money printing, suicide, or the destruction of swathes of supply, war. Provoking an open global confrontation nobody can emerge from in conditions of total collapse. Whilst the economic reality of the dollar's fall provides a powerful proof that we are witnessing the end of US hegemony, it is in observing the practice of geopolitical competition following the outbreak of COVID-19 that this becomes undeniable. The case of Iran is illustrative. The US's strategy of maximum pressure, intended to bring oil exports to zero, has crippled medical imports into the country, with imports of pharmaceuticals from Europe in particular falling sharply following the Trump administration's withdrawal from the so-called Iran deal in 2018. On the 26th of March, this noose was tightened, the US placing a new round of sanctions on the nation. This has produced a cataclysmic outbreak among the Iranian population, with one COVID-19 death recorded a minute at the infection's height. However, it has also served to considerably undermine the US. On the 2nd of April, Britain, France and Germany broke US sanctions and delivered medical support to Iran through their long-delayed INSTEX exchange mechanism. The US has yet to retaliate against Europe's imperialists, as it cannot follow through on its threat of extending sanctions without further exacerbating the fall of the dollar. It has run out of methods by which to attack Iran, save for raw relations of force. The result is a delirious charge, saturated by farce, with, for example, the US attempting to uphold an arms embargo on Iran by evoking the same deal it withdrew from in 2018. A similar process can be seen with regard to the US's posture against China. Following repeated claims from the Trump administration that China had created COVID-19 at a lab in Wuhan, France made clear that there was no factual evidence for this assertion, as the lab in question is a joint French-Chinese project, which has been repeatedly inspected by French officials. Despite this undermining, the US has persisted in these pithy attempts to gain economic ground, demanding reparations and suggesting that it may pull out of the Phase 1 China trade deal, as China is presently unable to purchase the level of soybeans this deal indicates due to COVID-19. With only a handful of supporters for this position, considerably undermined by the medical support China has provided to the world through the pandemic, the US has resorted to tantrum, withdrawing payments from the World Health Organization on the 14th of April, arguing it had supplied fake news of China's handling of the virus. There are a number of other examples, but the essence of these developments is clear. The US's aggression is now severing every alliance upon which it depends. Its instruments of soft power are failing, and its dominance evaporating in a practical sense. Rather than stalling the US's charge to war, this has had the impact of intensifying it. This can be seen on a number of fronts. Following the US's failure to economically isolate Iran, Trump gave orders that US warships in the Gulf shoot down and destroy Iranian vessels if they are viewed within 100 meters of the US, potentially placing the region a bullet away from erupting into an all-consuming torrent of fire and blood. In the South China Sea, tensions are rapidly escalating, with a call from US military researchers to hire pirates to attack Chinese vessels on the 10th of April. A confrontation between China's navy and a trespassing US warship on the 28th of April. And a threat that the US may cut off all relations with China on the 14th of May. Of course, it is in Latin America, which the US views as its backyard, that its aggression is sharpest. A failed invasion of Venezuela launched and stopped on the 3rd of May. With each of these increasingly desperate bids to exert itself militarily, the US is pulling the whole world into an apocalyptic war. As its nuclear policy, which suggests that a nuclear strike may restore strategic stability, something today definitively lost, and the COVID-19 infections running rampant through its armed forces indicate, the US would rather annihilation than defeat.
Think about how the world would be if you tried to quarantine everybody because of the generic type flu. Now, I'm not saying this is the generic type flu, but maybe we'd be just better off if we gave it to everybody.
As many have observed, the extremity of the collapse today in motion is providing fertile ground for immense reaction and repression under the guise of fighting the virus. Whilst the lockdowns are certainly imposed upon capitalist society by the realities of the virus, this is evidently clear in oppressed nations where fascism was gaining strength before the pandemic. The Philippines provides the most grotesque example, with the fascist President Duterte saying that the army should shoot those breaking the lockdown dead on the 2nd of April. But there are many others. In India, beatings for breaching lockdown are commonplace, and plans are underway to forcibly test medication upon those in Mumbai's slums. In Hungary, the President Orban has seized the moment to allow himself to rule by decree, and began by banning transgender people from transitioning. In Brazil, the lockdown is being used to forward a war on the Amazon's indigenous population, who, overcome by COVID-19, face further deforestation and attacks from those seeking to claim the rainforest's wealth. A final clearance. These brazen and naked fascist projects, however, were all well entrenched before the pandemic hit, in no small part due to the political, economic, and military support given to them by the imperialist nations. This explains how they have been able to move with such decisive force through the storm brought by the virus. The same cannot be said of the imperialist nations through the first 3 months of the pandemic, particularly Britain and the US, where accusations of fascism are most often aimed in the Anglophone world.
Now, if it's COVID-related, I guess we can talk about it, but we'd want certain things also, including sanctuary city adjustments, because we have so many people in sanctuary cities.
In these nations, what emerges is a rather stranger politics, predicated upon a combination of executive and media power, rather than the direct exercise of force. Fascism has, as yet, been unable to consolidate itself in the imperialist nations due to a number of factors, the economic hollowing of its police forces among them, but chiefly as it hasn't substantial enough social influence to consolidate itself. The result is a sustained infighting among the bourgeois classes of the imperialist nations, as indicated by Congress's failed attempt to impeach Trump in the US, or Dominic Cummings's intent to gut the British civil service. Since 2016, the combination of executive power and media advantage has allowed fascism, in particularly the US, certain situational advantages, a power greatly exaggerated by the US president's capacity to issue executive orders. With the outbreak of the coronavirus, the situational advantage of these forces has drastically weakened, and the contest between different factions within the national bourgeoisies of the imperialist nations deepened. The particular concern over which this battle manifests is at present the lockdown. In Britain, as a split within the cabinet and the broader Conservative Party, in the US, between certain states and the federal government. The example of the US is particularly illustrative of this conjecture. Driven by a desire to gain competitive advantage by reopening its economy quickly, the Trump administration is determined to lift the lockdown, irrespective of any health danger. Strangely, he does not have the executive power to order states to reopen. This has produced a strategy which has relied upon other means of executive coercion and the mobilisation of what social basis Trump does have, essentially a somewhat narrow and static band of poorer small business owners, to attempt to force states to reopen. This produced a number of protests, seeded and promoted by Trump's Twitter, with armed wings outside places of local state power across the US, but did not reveal a social force capable of resolving the dispute. Whilst the push to reopen the economy ahead of conditions of medical safety is winning out in both the US and Britain, it is doing so at a slow pace with considerable pushback, rather than at the pace decided by a dominant fascist social force. However, this circumstance has already matured, with Trump attempting to fully assert his fascist project in the United States in response to uprisings sparked by the murder of George Floyd. Police brutality is rampant, and anti-fascism is to be treated as terrorism. This process of violence and terror, which erupted as this film was being completed, will be considered in detail in our next release.
And I'm afraid that violent economic centrifuge is operating on human beings who are already very far from equal in raw ability, if not in spiritual worth. Whatever you may think of the value of IQ tests, it is surely relevant to a conversation about equality that as many as 16% of our species have an IQ below 85.
14 residents have now died in a fortnight after an outbreak at Oak Springs home around the corner, with two-thirds of staff off ill at one stage, including the manager. One relative, whose grandmother is inside but who asked to remain anonymous, likened it to her being trapped in a fire and he couldn't save her.
You know, it felt like my nan was in that burning building, and it was difficult to get a response to it. And as I've said all along, you know, the only difference is with this is you just can't see the fire. The fire is a virus.
One care assistant working in a home with an outbreak didn't want to be identified, but told us of lack of PPE, panic and fear as they cope with rising deaths.
Even though I was at my own mother's death, I've seen dead bodies before. I have never laid a body out. And on one day, I laid two out in an hour, and nothing could prepare you for that.
The utility of this observation is to highlight that what is today guiding the atrocities confronting us is not any political project, but rather the chaos resulting from collapse. This becomes clear when considering those projects fascism has been able to mount, which largely amount to a shaping of this collapse in certain ways. The already noted eugenics campaign underway against Britain's elderly and disabled population is a key example. It is no exaggeration to say that Britain's social care sector would have collapsed from the weight of the COVID-19 crisis without government intervention to prompt it. A point made clear by a statement from 10 homes in the northeast of England that the sector faces total collapse in the absence of funding in late May. Fascist forces have thus given a nudge to these structural contradictions in a bid to ensure that they become lethal. Cost-cutting ahead of any need to nationalise the industry. This can be drawn from a number of examples in the 2020 Coronavirus Act. For example, the decision to give medical practitioners legal immunity has created an aggressive increase in the issuing of do not attempt resuscitation notices against particularly the elderly, autistic, and those with learning disabilities, allowing councils to withdraw funding from social care has allowed the government to force COVID-19 patients into care homes by threatening cuts should they refuse them. These actions have greatly accelerated the process of death generated by the collapse of the care sector. But they are a catalyst, not a cause. The same can be said of the processes unfolding in other national care services, prisons, or other such systems of dependence and repression, which broadly mirror those seen in the British care industry in their own discrete contexts. What emerges from this understanding is twofold. Fascism in the imperialist West today is in part but a bureaucratic management of collapse and annihilation. Processes capitalism now cannot withdraw from. The collapse of social dependence is not possible to separate from genocide. But today, merely one of its forms. That the violence of this collapse may swiftly extend beyond its present premises is evident when one considers the problems of unemployment and food supply. On the 7th of April, the UN's labour body predicted that the crisis set in motion by COVID-19 would eliminate 195 million jobs worldwide within the second quarter of 2020 alone. 6.7% of total work hours. As the crisis continues to deepen and governments withdraw from the support they presently offer to businesses. This surge will pick up pace, and the systems of dependence put in place to manage the unemployed will come under such strain they either collapse or are consciously destroyed. The mass starvation and poverty resulting from this will not be contained to the unemployed. The downward pressure exerted upon wages by this mass dispossession will see those lucky enough to retain a job face much the same fate. Already, both of these tendencies are evident, with 1.5 million people unable to feed themselves for at least one day by the end of just the third week of lockdown in Britain. And Amazon, who have increased their profits through the crisis, announcing their intent to cut the wages of warehouse workers in Canada on the 16th of May. Not only this, the damage caused to food production by the virus threatens to see this process become generalized, with the World Food Programme predicting that the pandemic will push an additional 130 million people to starvation. The process of collapse and annihilation being experienced in the care sector is coming to define the development of imperialist capitalism as a whole. That capitalism is today embarking upon its final breakdown can be expressed by a number of economic realities. Near zero prices, flat productivity growth, zero, even negative interest rates, absurd debts, exhausted currencies, or by reference to the concrete processes of its collapse. Yet, it is perhaps best approached in view of that which capitalism today offers as its last real solution, the so-called Fourth Industrial Revolution. This term refers to a number of developing technologies like artificial intelligence or automation. Before the outbreak of the coronavirus, this tendency of capitalist development had already made a considerable impact, with huge data repositories accumulated, a so-called green industrial revolution on the tip of many a bourgeois tongue, and automation becoming increasingly normal. Since the virus hit, it has picked up pace considerably, with Microsoft boasting 2 years worth of digital transformation in 2 months, Google and Apple offering to combine their services in the pursuit of a contact tracing app, and half of the companies in 45 countries saying they intended to speed up plans to automate, some to as fast as 6 months. Whilst this might make it appear that capitalism is about to transform into something much worse, a sort of digital feudalism, the reality is that capitalism is incapable of completing this process. Two possibilities linger. The first, that capitalism continues to produce this infrastructure, leads only to extinction. The Green New Deal's proposed to enable it, requiring a 111% increase in resource extraction, thus irreparably hastening the climate crisis. The second, that these developments fall to ruin, is more likely. The capitalist system is premised upon the exploitation of human labour power. Its crises drawn from the fact that increasingly productive machines reduce the amount of labour employed by investment, reducing the rate of profit. Automation raises this premise to the scale of breakdown, abolishing the exploitation of labour as the dominant source of wealth, and thus the premises of capitalist production. It is clear that this process of self-abolition is already encroaching upon its limits. The parasitic nature of the capital which upholds this technology, making it particularly vulnerable to any long-term collapse. And the intrusion upon older industries such a transformation requires, necessitating considerable struggle among all classes. Already, these contradictions are being felt in considerably antagonistic ways, with, for example, US health companies launching an attempt to sue volunteers 3D printing ventilator parts on the 18th of March. This is to say that we are entering a stage of development where, as Marx wrote in 1859, the material productive forces of society come into conflict with the existing relationships of production.
There's never been a vaccine project anywhere in history like this. And I just want to make something clear. It's very important. Vaccine or no vaccine, we're back. And we're starting the process.
But we do want to see children back in school, because we know how much children grow and benefit from being in school. We can now start for planning for a very limited return to school for some pupils, potentially as early as next month.
As the trickle toward the lifting of lockdowns begins, with all signs pointing to a second wave of COVID-19 infections, in particularly the imperialist West, it is crucial that we are clear upon the real significance of this reality. In the early pangs of its final breakdown, capitalist society is already identifiable only with annihilation. This is to say that the capitalist class are forming into an extinction cult through the processes of breakdown and collapse. The methods by which they are able to stave off crisis, identified by Marx and the Polish Marxist Heinrich Grossman as the export of capital, the lowering of wages, increasing productivity, or war, must today all be exerted as they were in response to the Great Depression, though they may lead only to social collapse and apocalyptic destruction. This is so whether the virus remains or is defeated, as what it has set in motion provides no room to withdraw. And so we are in the drift of the last clearances, the first shots of the last war, and the ghostly cries of long-forgotten barricades. If we do not stand against this nightmare, it shall consume us. The solution, as with the disease, is as Marx prescribed it: socialism. Do not hold back your tears, my dear, nor stifle your screams. Let no complaint go unuttered. Before what seems to be the end of all things, the pain, fear, and agony you feel can show only one thing: you are still human. And in the pull of a tide such as ours, that is a truly remarkable thing. For what is today being buried is not only our disabled friends and family, our mothers and grandmothers, the loved ones shackled in the dank cells of immigration, mental and general prisons, or the bodies broken on battlefields and borders, but the human soul. Capitalism, now fully realized as an extinction cult, has snuffed out something in many a still beating chest. What has changed is hard to pinpoint, but it is meant and felt in every callus. Only the vulnerable will die. The genocidal insistence that sacrifice must be made to the market god, and the economy reopened immediately, or in the absurdism of the US's propaganda drive to nuclear contest. In these expressions, there is no human life, but a deadness. They are but the last orders of a system so decayed as to have become cancerous. So alienated from the species, to treat its followers as disposable cattle. So delusional, to believe itself immortal at the very hour of its ruin. And so you must know that to feel and shout in the rage of solidarity in this age is more precious than air. It is to join in the common defense of our species, from which we shall finally emerge as one. The way is dark, but there is room yet for heart. For look what has happened. The old world is dead, and it is never coming back. In its ruins can be glimpsed the first pangs of a new world of love, solidarity, and cooperation. So even this end may yet be a beginning. We are in the first breath of either the last syllable of recorded time, or the most glorious dawn to have ever graced this fair earth. Workers and oppressed of all lands, unite.
Now existence, you see, is something that is spontaneous. The Chinese word for nature, Ziran, means that which happens of itself. Your hair grows by itself. Your heart beats by itself. You breathe pretty much by itself. You don't have voluntary control over these things. So we say it happens spontaneously. So when you go to sleep and you try to go to sleep, you interfere with the spontaneous process of going to sleep. Try to breathe, you know, real hard, and you find you get balled up in your breathing. You've got to let go and let it happen.